is.
There's just something about him that makes me quiver. Is he here often?
Just one day a week.
What day?
Tuesday.
Is he ever alone? I mean, does Ramon ever go off and leave him here alone?
Sometimes. Why?
I'd like to know. Please, tell Ramon to warn me when he's going to leave me alone with that one person.
All right, that'll make you feel better.
Now, this goes on for quite a while. I like how she asks, what day? With Kathleen Turner dreaming up all sorts of excuses for not having sex with Steve Martin. And this leads him to consult his boss at the hospital.
How are things at home, Michael? Great. I'm married to the most beautiful woman in the world. How could it be anything but great? It's gonna be even greater! Just as soon as we...
6 weeks and you haven't made love to your wife yet? No wonder you're tense.
Dr. Brandon, the woman has just had major brain surgery. She's had enough unpleasantness. I'll have you know that in the finger-sucking department, I am extremely satisfied.
Have you ever been to Austria, Michael?
No.
The Austrian Institute of Craniology has asked many times for you to lecture there on your theory of brain transplant. Why not take them up on it? Find a business trip with a honeymoon.
Honeymoon. Yeah. I gotta do something to get us started. When are you scheduled to have your hands removed from your face?
3 o'clock this afternoon.
And you could do the Voigtlander surgery for me.
Of course.
Gotta be very careful with that instant glue, don't you, Brandon?
That's great, hands removed. It's hard to argue about comedies, but I found both of those scenes to be very funny, and the movie goes on from sex jokes to become a parody of all those mad scientist movies, with Martin falling in love with the brain of another woman, just her brain, which is located in a big, big jelly jar. He puts red wax lips on the jar to make her more human. It's all very silly, and I thought quite funny.
I am of two minds about this movie, so to speak.
Perfect.
I laughed part of the time. I didn't laugh the rest of the time. I have sort of a resistance to Steve Martin, which I think comes out of the fact that I thought The Jerk was a terrible movie, and that the other movie, Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid, was not so great either. And I really think maybe either he's getting better or I'm beginning to get the idea, because there were times in this movie when I really laughed, even though I can't quite recommend the whole film. I thought it was too repetitive and not really original, if you've seen Young Frankenstein.
This stuff, his humor is repetitive. He really takes the situation and goes wild with it. I mean, the running up the wall and all of these things. I think he's very original. I think he's onto something very good here. His character is more likable. It's less inside joking. I think he really has his hands on a really fine script.
So you recommend it?
Absolutely. Very
funny. I don't quite,
film.
But I'll tell you this much. After this film, for the first time, I'm looking forward to the next Steve Martin film.
Okay.
Next at the movies, Superman turns mean, vindictive, and a little short-tempered in Superman 3.
Hi, honey.
I don't know you, lady.
It's the other night.
I'm sorry, but that wasn't me.
Our next movie is Superman 3, the third in what could be an endless series of adventures starring the mild-mannered reporter who turns into the Man of Steel. And in this adventure, Superman has a new friend and a new enemy. The friend is played by Richard Pryor as a computer programmer who's enlisted by the enemy, who's played by Robert Vaughn. And Vaughn's plan is to use an Earth satellite to change the world's weather and become a multi-billionaire by cornering the commodities market. In this scene, Vaughn uses computers to toy with Superman.
He's here.
Good. Let's give him something to worry about. Tracking system's locked.
Oh,
And here's Richard Pryor's own personal explanation of the Man of Steel.
His cape was flapping in the wind. He was flying. He was great. He was just flying around. Shh. The cape was blowing in the wind like this. Shh. Looked like a flag. Shh. And he landed right in the middle of this big plantation. Shh. Dun, 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 dun. And he looked, checked everything out, right, with his x-ray vision before he did that. And then he put these laser beams out of his eyes onto everything. Straight out laser beams. Dried up everything, just like that.
Richard Pryor is the best thing in Superman 3. Maybe because we know Pryor's basic character so well, it's interesting to see how he reacts to being trapped inside a Superman movie. But the movie never does as much as it could with the relationship between Richard Pryor and Superman. Instead, it devotes most of its time to a series of stunts and spectacular special effects, like this scene near the beginning of the story.
Get me the number 3 ladder truck in here. It will reach. My God, they're trapped. What's he gonna do? Climb down one at a time?
That's fun. A lot of Superman 3 is fun, but this movie is more simple-minded than the other two Superman films. It all but ignores Superman's dual identity as Daily Planet reporter Clark Kent, and that was always fun in the first two films, that contrast between these two different kinds of characters. And this movie gives Superman a little love interest with Annette O'Toole, but oddly enough, their love affair is pretty standard. It could happen between any two people. It doesn't depend upon the fact that Clark Kent is Superman. Superman 3 doesn't have the human touch of the first two movies. It doesn't have the interest in what a person would be like if he were invincible or nearly invincible. And Superman 3, well, it's well made, it's entertaining, but it's got too many stunts and it's just not quite special.
I like it even less than you did. It does something I didn't think a Superman movie could ever do for me, and that is bore me. This movie is missing a great love affair. That's what the first two pictures had. Interesting love affairs, Clark and Lois, Superman and Lois. Mm-hmm. Marvelous stuff. Here, just that little love story with Lana Lang and the hometown girl and Clark, and that should have been the back half of the movie. Instead, as you say, more stunts. Richard Pryor, wasted here. He's a goody-goody guy, not real evil.
I was disappointed. I think that Richard Pryor is always best in the movies when he's anarchic, when he's an enemy of the establishment, when he's an outsider, stirring things up. And here, he's a nice little guy. You pat him on the head, he's a schmo, he's Superman's pal. Don't drop me, Superman. He's too nice in this movie. He ought to get in there and really mess things up.
Ever since his accident, he's been playing nicer and nicer guys. I want him to be real, real evil. Coming up next at the movies, Dan Aykroyd and Eddie Murphy playing a rich kid and a bum who trade places.
Oh, you lying, filthy, disgusting creep!
Our next film, Trading Places, to my mind, is the funniest film of the year so far. Trading Places stars Eddie Murphy as a street hustler and Dan Aykroyd as a wealthy commodities trader who trade places as part of a cool bet to see which is more important, heredity or environment. The Three Stooges used to do that all the time, that gimmick. Aykroyd works for two very rich brothers who bet each other on whether Aykroyd or Murphy will become different if they take away Aykroyd's money and home and give it all to Murphy. And here's the scene where Murphy is in his new home, which he, as a street hustler, can't believe really belongs to him.
I like it, Randy. It's very nice. I like the way you got the mirrors and stuff hooked up over there. It's very pretty. I like that. I like that mirror.
I don't think he understands, Randolph.
Oh, well, Marty, I do understand.
William.
Yeah.
This is your home.
Uh-huh. Right.
It belongs to you.
Yeah, all this is mine. I like my home. It's very nice. That's very nice tasting houses. I like
everything
it.
You see in this room is yours now.
Uh-huh. This is my stuff.
Your own personal property?
Yeah, my own personal.
You understand?
It's mine. Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, you know what I like most about my place, Randy? The curtains, man. Look at the curtains. It's beautiful the way I got this place set up, man. This is something else. I like it. The cabinets and whatnot.
Beautiful. I suppose you're going to just give me this TV set for free, huh, Randy?
That's right.
Uh-huh. Everything in here is mine, huh? Oh, I guess the stereo is mine free too, huh?
Absolutely. This is too much for me, man. You know, I can really dig this, Randy. You know why? This kind of thing happens to me every week.
Eddie Murphy is just marvelous in this film. He's funny and a fine actor, too. That's important. But his story, and this is the nice part, is only half of this movie. Dan Aykroyd's story is the other half. Those same wealthy brothers arrange for Aykroyd to lose his job, his money, and his reputation, and he winds up being arrested on false charges, and when he gets out of jail, his snooty fiance wants no part of him, especially after a hooker approaches him.
Listen, fellow, I swear to you, on my honor, with Almighty God as my witness, I am not an angel dust dealer.
Louis.
I've been looking everywhere for you, baby. Listen, Louis, I'm hurting, baby. I just need to show you.
Louis, who is this person?
I've never seen this woman before in my life.
Don't say that. Come on, baby. Just a dime bag.
You lying, filthy, disgusting creep.
Grand. Great. Thanks a lot.
It was a joke. Your friend said it would get you off.
You mean someone told you to do this to me?
Yeah, and he paid me $100, too. It's right over there.
That was Jamie Lee Curtis as the hooker, and she's been set up to do this, of course, by the brothers. This is an extremely well-made movie, a lot more ambitious than we expect it to be for a comedy. We get the two stories of those transformations, and the picture goes even beyond that. It's a good-looking film, exceptionally well-cast, and at the center of it all, Eddie Murphy, who at the age of 22 is now a major star. I think he can do anything in front of a camera, comedy and serious parts as well. Very special.
I'm right with you, Gene. I love this movie. I laughed all the way through it. I thought it was terrific. One of the things I liked best about it was the fact that it goes back to a Hollywood tradition of the 30s and 40s, to pictures by people like Frank Capra and Preston Sturges, who told stories. And the stories became comic, but they became comic because they had insights into human nature.
Yes.
And Aykroyd and Murphy here, they're not just playing the shtick that we see on television.
Right.
They're playing characters and making those characters real.
That's a very good point. We're beyond Animal House now. We're beyond beer cans being crushed into people's head, juvenile stuff. Mm-hmm. This is well-made adult comedy filmmaking. These guys are very good. I want to credit the director, John Landis, who handles big action scenes very well. He did the Blues Brothers, and he does this film, and he loves big action scenes, and they're fun. It's mounted very well, rather than one of these cheap teenage comedies.
He also does a lot of good casting with the smaller roles. Ralph Bellamy,
absolutely.
Donna McKee.
Bo Diddley is a pawnbroker in this film. Terrific.
Next is the movie Psycho 2. It's 22 years later, and Anthony Perkins is back at the Bates Motel again as the most famous mad slasher in movie history.
Something wrong, Norman?
Okay, now this next movie we have is one that no true movie buff or lover believes could ever really be made. The name of the movie is Psycho 2, and this movie has the presumption to believe that Sir Alfred Hitchcock didn't finish his story with the original Psycho back in 1960. Well, I walked into this movie with a certain amount of resistance just to the idea of any movie called Psycho 2 because I admire the original Psycho so much. But the opening half hour of the movie is sort of creepy because it reminds us so convincingly of Norman Bates, played by Anthony Perkins, and of the violent events at the Bates Motel. Look at this scene from early in the film. Anthony Perkins hardly seems to have changed at all since 1960.
Kill you.
That scene is a direct reference back to the original Psycho. Later in this movie, Bates offers shelter to a young girl who triggers his old phobias.
But this is yours.
No, go ahead. You have it. I'll make myself another.
Do you have a knife?
No, I'm afraid I don't. I just moved back here after being many years away, and I forgot to bring any cutlery.
That's odd. People usually leave something, even if it is only an old butter knife. Ah, there. Aren't you going to eat?
No, I just suddenly lost my appetite, but you go ahead, enjoy it.
Now, there's one question you have to ask yourself. Will an audience that isn't familiar with the original Psycho get the same kind of charge out of that knife scene that we do?
Yes, I think I like the sound effect of the knife scraping on the plate. Okay, that was nice.
I think it means a little more of, you know, what Norman Bates has been up to earlier in his life.
A little more.
There's one thing Norman Bates should have learned during his 2 decades of psychiatric treatment is that he never, ever should have gone back inside that house again. But he does. And then another series of murders breaks out, and Norman thinks he's going crazy, which is a little ironic. Psycho 2 isn't a bad movie, but it's not really a worthy sequel to Psycho either. I'd suggest that the best way to enjoy this movie would be to try to put the original Psycho just totally out of your mind. But the problem is the very first opening scene of Psycho makes that impossible, because what they do is repeat Hitchcock's shower scene. And by letting Sir Alfred have the first word, they let him have the last word, too.
Yeah, this is a tricky film. I think audiences would generally enjoy it, but I'm going to make my comments on grading, if you will, reviewing this specific movie. And it does nothing extra than the original film did. What I like about sequels that are good, like Godfather 2 or Rocky 2 or even Superman 2, is that they take the characters into new places. This is basically a retread with sort of a wink at the audience, and it's played as much for laughs as it is for horror. I just don't think it was anything special. We don't need this movie.
I think, well, first of all, that's right. And then secondly, do you think it would have been more interesting to have Norman Bates go out into real society, move to San Francisco or Denver or something,
yeah,
try to get involved in things?
I think the ghost of the original obviously hangs over this production, and it's too bad, because it's a nicely made picture.
Nicely made, but you're quite right, it's unnecessary.
We copy. Okay, now to recap our reactions to the 4 films on this show. Roger and I split on Steve Martin's The Man with Two Brains, Roger finding Martin's humor sort of cold and self-involved. I disagree. I thought he was terrifically silly. We agreed that Superman 3 is the weakest of the 3 Superman movies. Neither one of us can recommend you see it. We both thought that Eddie Murphy and Dan Aykroyd were very funny in Trading Places. I think it's the funniest film of the year so far. And finally, 2 downturned thumbs for Psycho 2, a well-made but weak carbon copy of the great Alfred Hitchcock thriller.
So the verdict very clearly is 2 big yeses for Trading Places.
And if you got in the mind for another comedy, Man with Two Brains.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next time we'll have reviews of 4 new movies, including The Survivors, a comedy with Robin Williams and Walter Matthau.
Well, Mr. Honky Mofo, take your best shot!
Until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Enjoy another favorite from the makers of Raisinets, Goobers, and Snow Caps. Bit of honey with 6 chewy pieces in every bar.